We're going to be in John chapter 9 today. Again, John is developing the person of Christ, but this is almost an acted out parable. Now, I'm not saying there wasn't really a blind man at the gate that wasn't born blind, but from verses 39 through 44, I think it's obvious that what we have is physical blindness and physical sight and spiritual blindness and spiritual sight. We have a parable of a man who has never had the joy of sight. And we have a group of men who claim to see but are blind. It's almost the Matthew passage of the guy trying to get the speck out of his brother's eye when he has a log in his own. This is almost an acted out drama of that kind of setting. You know, Jesus healed more blind people than any other thing he did. And there were all kinds of different ways that he did it. Spit on the ground, made clay, spit in their eyes, spoke, touched their eyes, on and on. But this was a characteristic of his ministry. And I think that has a messianic connotation. You might want to see Isaiah 29:18, 35:5, 42:7, and Matthew 11:5, where that's a sign of the messianic age. Okay? Let's look at our text, if we could, then. As he passed by along, he saw a man who had been blind from his birth. I wonder how he knew that. You think this guy was so well known that everybody in the area knew he was blind from birth? He had told everybody? I don't know, but it was known, whether Jesus is supernatural insight or just common knowledge. So his disciples, and that's surprising because this is the first mention of his disciples. Because the other previous chapters, his disciples were not with him at the Feast of Tabernacles. Apparently, this may be the Judean disciples mentioned in chapter 7, verse 3. I'm just not sure. And they ask him, Rabbi, for whose sin was this man born blind, his own or his parents? Now, that has caused a lot of commentary. Our world is being highly influenced by speculative Greek Oriental thought, which is primarily cyclical. It follows the season of nature. And therefore, the wheel of karma, reincarnation, is an Eastern thought that in a recent survey, over half Americans believed in reincarnation. Now, the Bible does present a set pattern of men's activity, but it's moving toward a point of history. So if you're coming and looking for a proof text for reincarnation, this is probably one that you quote, and many cult groups do quote this as a proof text for the wheel of karma. But we must not look in Eastern religions. We must look in rabbinical theology. Now, some later rabbinical theology was influenced by the Greek concept of the transmigration of the immortal soul. But that's after Jesus' age. Those later rabbis said that all of the souls of men were in the Garden of Eden. And that's just, you know, that's not even Judaism. That's Greek philosophy influencing Judaism. But you say, well, what could possibly be the background of the Old Testament? Well, there are two possible backgrounds. Number one, in Genesis 25:22, remember where Jacob and Esau wrestled in the womb before they were born? And Jacob came out after his brother, but he had him grabbed him by the heel. Now, the word means usurper. So that was that Jacob was even premeditating evil when he was a pre-born child, prenatal sin. The rabbis developed from that concept. Prenatal activity in a spiritual realm is not unknown in the New Testament. Remember when John the Baptist, in the womb of his mother Elizabeth, leaped for joy at the presence of Mary? So see, there's another unborn child reacting to spiritual presence. So the rabbis developed that a child could sin prenatally. Now, secondly, many rabbis believed that children could be affected by the sin of their parent. Now, a good example would be Exodus chapter 20, verse 5, that he will visit the sins of the father to the third and fourth generation. In our day, we can see something of that. If a mother has syphilis and they don't know it, and the child's eyes, they don't put that special, some kind of silver nitrate or something, the child will be blind from the sin of the mother. Or did you know if the parents are drug addicts, especially the mother, that the child will be born a drug addict and has to go off the drugs just like the mother? Well, there's a very easily to see example of how the children are affected by the parent, as well as the lifestyle priorities which we communicate to our children. Now, something else here I think is very important. We need to realize that although sin and sickness don't have an A always results in B effect, that there's often a link between sin and physical illness. Now, I want to give you a couple examples. In James chapter 5, there's an obvious link between confessing our sins and being healed. But in John chapter 5, verse 14, Jesus also mentions about the man that he healed said, "Now you quit sinning or something worse will befall you." So I'm not saying that there's not a connection between sin and sickness, but I am saying it's not an automatic connection. This was not an automatic connection here with this man. Now, notice what he says. Jesus answered, "It is neither for his own sin or for that of his parents, but to show what God could do." A little more literally would be that the works of God might be shown. Well, here is Jesus saying it's not because of sin. It's that the glory of God might be revealed in this man. Do you mean this man was born blind and lived however large part of his childhood and some of his adulthood in blindness so that God might be magnified in his healing? Yes. Yes, I do. Now, I don't say that I understand all that, but that is the obvious input from this text. Do you mean that God can take evil and use it to good? Yes. I'm not saying God caused this man's illness, but I'm saying God used this man's illness and changed it into good. And he does that. Now, this idea about what is the works of God, it's mentioned three times in here, twice in verse 4, once in verse 3. What is the work of God? I think we're confused in the modern church. We have that the will of God is to build a big church, lots of people, lots of money, lots of activity. Chapter 6, verse 28 and 29 tells us what the work of God is. It is the salvation of men. Anything we do that's not directly related to the evangelism of lost people is not the will of God for the church. I don't care how successful, how needed, on and on. Everything we do, even our social ministry, even our worship, even our Christian training, are to point toward the redemption of lost men for whom God weeps over, a world rebelling against his Creator. Now, notice it says in verse 4, notice the we and the me. Doesn't that sound funny, the we and the me? The pronouns don't jive. We must continue to do the works of him who sent me while it is daylight. Now, what does that mean? Well, I think it's this truth that as the Father sent Jesus, so he sends us. As Jesus is the light of the world, so his followers become the light of the world. Matthew 5:14. The church is the continuing incarnation of God on earth. We are the salt. We are the light. And that's what I think the we and the me are. It comes to Jesus, and then it flows to us. Now, notice where it says, night is coming when no one can work. Let me give you a few references on the idea of night coming. John 3:19. 11, 9, and 10, 12, 35, and 36. You know, this is the idea about the darkness of people's hearts. There's going to come a day when men won't respond to the gospel. Now, I know America is not real responsive today, but there are parts of the world that are in full-blown Holy Spirit-led revival. Thank God. There's going to come a day toward the end time where people are going to get teachers that just tell them what they want to hear. There's going to come a time of rebellion and hostility between parents and children. It's coming. It's a sign of the end time. We must work while we have light. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, our lives, we are stewards of them. We don't know how many hours or days we might have, but while we have opportunity, let's do the works of him while we can. There's going to come a day, there's going to come a generation, when as much as you want to do for God, you won't be able to do it. Now's the time. We must strike while the iron is hot. Now, then it says, while I am in the world, okay, I am the light of the world. Now, that has some messianic implications that are in your outline. We talked about it in the previous chapter so much, I won't go into it again this time. Now, notice verse 6. And on saying this, he spit on the ground and made clay. Now, this man can't see. But you know, people who can't see usually have a developed sense of hearing. Don't you know that guy heard this large crowd apparently come around him, and everybody was whispering, "It's Jesus. What he's going to do? I wonder what he's going to do." And suddenly he heard Jesus go, now, If you went in the doctor's office today and the guy spit and mixed his medicine with it and stuck it in your ear or on your eyes, you'd croak. But in that day, saliva was a common practice, especially for eye diseases. It wasn't a saliva that healed this man, but Jesus is working with this man's faith because he's going to tell him to go and wash. Aorist middle imperative. Go and wash in the pool of Siloam. The man has to hear and feel what Jesus is doing, and then he goes in faith to do it. This man didn't ask to be healed. Jesus is taking the initiative and coming to him. He's really a symbol of all men lost in the blindness of sin. Now, So he goes off to the pool. Now it mentions here the pool of Siloam. This was related to the ritual of the Feast of Tabernacles. Remember, I am the living water? And notice it says, which means one that has been sent. Now the word Siloam is another word for sent, like apostello. Now, the Jews developed a title for the Messiah around this term Siloam. But here, in reality, the word Siloam really seems to mean that the water was sent from the pool of Gihon. It was pumped outside into this pool. And that's what the literal means of the rabbis took it a little more spiritual or figurative. And he went home and washed them and went home seeing. And he went home, everybody was saying, are you the blind guy? No, you can't be the blind guy. He said, I'm the blind guy. Can you believe it? I can see. And his neighbors mentioned in verse 8. Now, there's three groups here. His neighbors in verse 8. The man himself is going to speak in verse 11. And then his parents are going to speak in verse 18. Now, these neighbors, these are great people. You'd love to live in this neighborhood. They said, oh, you can see? The man said, yeah. They said, what happened? He said, Jesus of Nazareth spit on the ground, made clay, put on my eyes, told me to wash, and now I can see. And they say, well, you come with us because we're taking you to the synagogue court because how dare you have your sight on the Sabbath? Holy moly. They're more concerned about the breaking of a nitpicking rule than they are of a man seeing. I think sometimes we are more concerned with our little nitpicking traditions and our little five and dime rules than we are with men and women's lives in eternity. We're more proud of what we don't do than we are of who we win to Christ and lead them to maturity. Here's this group of neighbors drag this man, the Pharisees, and they start haranguing him. They say, what happened to you? Tell us about this. He said, look, I don't know. A man named Jesus made some clay, put on my eyes. Now notice he calls him a man here in verse 11. In verse 17, he's going to call him a prophet. And later on in verse 38, he's going to call him Lord. What a development. This man's not saved until the very end. Here's a good example that physical healing does not automatically mean spiritual healing, but Jesus is bringing this man along. Now, let me continue. Let's get on to verse 13. So they took the man who had been blind to the Pharisees, okay? Notice they're called the Jews in 18 and 22, but specifically the Pharisees in 13, 15, 16, and 40. Same group, religious leaders. Now it was on the Sabbath. Oh, there's the kicker. You might want to see chapter 5, verse 9. Jesus almost did this on purpose on the Sabbath. Now I don't know if he healed people every day of the week, and the Gospels only record the Sabbath because of the theological controversy, or if Jesus just healed folks on the Sabbath to bring into sharp focus who he is and God's heart over against the religious leaders of rabbinical Judaism. Friends, religiosity is sometimes the greatest barrier between God and man. Now, so in verse 15, they ask him over and over, what's happening? What did you do? He tells them again and again. Look at verse 15. Now, in verse 16, some of the Pharisees said, this man does not come from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. And others said, how can a sinful man perform such wonders? Now, here's the logic and the syllogism. Anyone who breaks the Sabbath is a sinner. Jesus broke the Sabbath. Conclusion, Jesus is a sinner. But the other group, no man since the history of the world has healed a man born blind. Only God can heal a man born blind. Jesus is from God. Now there's the two groups. Now see, it's more perception than it is truth. And sometimes our perception makes all the difference. How we view a fact, how we view an act, how we view a truth. Now, so they begin to talk to this man. And again, they asked the blind man, what do you say about him yourself, since it is you who made his eyes to see? Now, this is strange that here all these PhDs in religion are going to ask this man a religious question, right? And this man is sharp. Man, I tell you, he may be a blind beggar, but he is one sharp cookie. And he first of all says, look, I don't know. All I know, I was blind, and now I see. Now, here he says, what do you think he is? He says, I think he's a prophet. Now, that was a good word. That probably went back to Deuteronomy 18:15. He was saying something very important about Jesus. But, boy, they say, aw. Now, they said, well, bring his parents in here. Let's try to confuse them and get them to say he really wasn't their son. So they bring the parents in. The parents are really intimidated. They're afraid of getting kicked out of the synagogue, as you can see from verse 22. There was obviously excommunication. We learn from rabbinical sources that one could be excommunicated for a week, a month, or permanently. And it seems like these Pharisees are not from the Sanhedrin, but a local synagogue court. You might want to see chapter 7, 47 through 49, which seems to be an excommunication procedure. And you might want to go back to Ezra chapter 10, verse 8, where it seems to be mentioned. So the parents were afraid, and they asked them the question. They said, look, this is our son. But what happened, we don't know. He's old enough, you ask him. Okay? So the Pharisees come back a second time to the man who's blind and said, give God praise. Now what they're saying is, we want you to tell the truth. Swear to God on a stack of Bibles. Cross your heart and hope to die. Stick a needle in my eye. This is an oath. They're saying, now you want you to tell the truth, guy. Don't you be lying now. Now it looks a little funny for us, but give God the glory is an oath formula. You might want to see Joshua 7:19. It's an aorist imperative. And this, then they add to it, we know this man's a sinner. Now isn't that, they're saying, tell the truth. Now this is what we want you to say. Isn't that what they're doing? The conclusion they've already reached. He's a sinner. Now you tell us the truth and confirm that conclusion. Well, that's a bit inappropriate. Well, this guy's going to hang them on the wall, I want to tell you. He answered, I do not know whether he's a sinner. I only know one thing. Once I was blind, now I see. That's pretty good logic. He said, I don't understand all the things you're haranguing me about, but I know this. I've been blind since day one, and for the first time in my life, I've seen light and beauty and joy. Now, so they come back and say, they ask him, what did he do to you? How did he make your eyes to see again? Now, if you look back over here in verse 15, they had asked him that question. They'd ask him that question over and over and over and over and over again. This guy got tired of it. This is what he said to him. Oh, he puts the bite on so bad. He says, I've already told you, and you would not listen to me. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples also? Oh, he just stuck the knife in and turned it. Now, this isn't the end of this, because he's going to do it again. Now, this deal about they thought he was a disciple. I think the man is advocating Jesus in the sense of saying, he's a prophet. He's a good man. He healed me. I don't know what you're accusing him of. But ladies and gentlemen, this man's not going to be a believer till later in this passage. You see, I don't think advocacy, I don't think affirming the facts about the life of Jesus, I don't think defending the Bible, I don't think just saying, I like Jesus, he's a good man, I think he's wonderful, that's not what makes one a Christian. There are going to be folks who have all the theological affirmations that you can imagine that aren't going to make heaven. For you see, heaven is determined by personal relationship, not by theological affirmations or apologetic advocacy. This man is for Jesus, but he's not a believer. Now, this is what the Pharisees say. You are a disciple yourself, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that Moses spoke from God, but we do not know where this fellow comes from. And the guy comes right back. Oh, what a mind this guy had. He said, is that right? You're the religious leaders of Israel. You know all the law of Moses. Here a man's healed my eyes, and I've been blind from birth. And you don't know where he's from? You who claim to know all spiritual things, you don't know where he's from? All those Pharisees went berserk. Friend, he nailed their hide to the wall. Now, so they said, well, you're just a sinful man. Listen to this. We know that God does not listen to sinful men, but he does listen to anyone who worships God and lives to do his will. It has never been heard of in this world that anyone ever made the eyes of a man who is born blind to see. If this man had come from God, he could not have done anything like this. Well, that guy really told him. And this is what they say. How dare you, upstart? You were born in iniquity. We're the religious leaders. Where do you get off talking to us like that? The guy could have said, you asked me. Look at verse 35. You were born in total depravity. Now, isn't it surprising that the rabbis do not have a doctrine of original sin? In rabbinical Judaism, they believe in the two impulses called the Yetzer Hara and the Yetzer HaTov, the good impulse and the bad impulse. And which one you choose determines your life. It's often called the black or the white dog in your heart. Now, I think there is some passages in the Old Testament that seem to imply original sin or the pervasiveness of the fall. Job 14:14 and Psalms 51:5 are very good ones. The classical definitive passage on original sin is Romans 5:12 and following by Paul. And yet you were trying to teach us. Now apparently they're going back to verse 2 where they say, was this man sin or his parents, he was born blind. They're assuming that he did something wrong, either prenatally or his parents, and that's why God cursed him with blindness. Now you see, leprosy and blindness and barrenness were all due in the rabbinical Judaism idea to God being mad at you. Now see, that's what the whole book of Job and Psalm 77 is all about. That's not true. But these guys still believe that. And they said, you're obviously a sinner or you wouldn't be born blind. So how dare you tell us what's spiritually true? And they turned him out. Now, Williams, my text, adds, of the synagogue. Now, basically, they're going back. It's not in the Greek text. They're going back to verse 22 and picking that up. Jesus heard this man had been turned out of the synagogue, so he found him and said to him, you know, isn't this beautiful? Jesus waited through this whole process. When they kicked this man out of their fellowship, now he would be excluded from all religious contact. It was a devastating thing. What if somebody said you can never go to church again? You can never partake of the Lord's Supper. You can never have a Bible study group. You can never have a prayer group. You can never fellowship with Christians. Oh, it was just devastating. Here's the man just had the greatest joy of his life, and then he just got kicked out of his religious tradition. Oh, it was traumatic. Oh, but Jesus. Jesus was coming to see him. You know, there's an English poem that calls God the bloodhound of heaven. I want to tell you, I like that. It's a little crude, but what it says is that anybody, anywhere, if ever stop and turn around, will find that God's on their trail in love. Friends, he's the one that took the initiative. He's the one that's looking for you. I don't care how far you've gone or where you are or how dirty you are. I want you to know God's on your path, my friend. If you'll just stop and be still, you'll find him right on your shoulder. Jesus went after this man, and he said to him, do you believe in the Son of Man yourself? Now, some versions have Son of God, manuscript A, which would be Alexandrinus. But Sinaiticus, Vaticanus, the Bottomer, and Chester Beatty Papyri all have Son of Man. So does Codex Bizet, or the King James Textus Receptus manuscript family. So I think Son of Man's better. Now, I don't know what this man understood by that. I think Jesus used that term to describe both humanity and deity. You see, that term originally meant humanity, like Ezekiel. Son of Man, stand on your feet, I will talk to you. But in Daniel 7:13, it came to mean something else. Here came a human being riding on the clouds of heaven, approaching the Ancient of Days, and the kingdom was given to him. Well, nobody rides on the clouds of heaven but deity. And so here we have the concept of human and divine together in one title. Now, what this man exactly understood, I am not sure. But he understood enough. Now, he had never seen Jesus before. Remember, he was blind. But I'm sure he recognized his voice. And look what he said. Who is he, sir? Tell me that I may believe in him. Remember, the word believe in Hebrew is primarily trust, faith, or belief. It's primarily a commitment to God's promises. Now, the word sir here is the word kurios. It's used again down in verse 38. My translation translates 36, sir, and 38, Lord. And that's probably good, because the term kurios can mean mister, can mean sir. But if it's used in a theological sense, it means this full-blown affirmation of the New Testament authors that Jesus was fully God and fully man. I believe that Jesus is Lord, I think, is the early church's baptismal formula. Whosoever shall call the name of the Lord, that beautiful passage in Romans 10, 9 through 13. So he first calls him, sir. Who is this that I may believe? And Jesus, I don't know who was standing around, but he looked him in the eye and said, you have seen him. Friends, you've got to be born blind before that verb jumps off the page to you. You have seen him, and you are talking to him right now. Jesus said, I'm him. I'm the Messiah, fella. Trust in me. Now, he didn't say, he didn't tell him what to trust or how to trust or didn't tell him the content. He just said, fella, put your trust in me. Focus on me. The Gospels do that. It is the person of Jesus and our trusting him that's the central foundation of personal relationship. Now, notice here where he said, then Jesus said, I have come into this world to judge people. But that seems so different from other passages. Because back in chapter 3, 17 through 21, and 12, 47 and 48, he said, I have not come into the world to judge the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And yet here, and in chapter 5, 22 and 27, he seems to say, I have come into the world to judge the world. Are these contradictions? No, I think not. Jesus came primarily the first time as the suffering servant of Isaiah to purchase the redemption of man. But friends, I want to tell you, he's coming again. The Jews expected him as the conquering judge and king of kings. He's coming back the way they thought he was coming the first time. Friends, you ain't seen no majesty yet till you see Jesus when he comes again in the clouds of heaven and the holy angels. He's coming again as the eschatological judge. He didn't come to judge men right now. He came to save men. But the very fact that Jesus Christ, God's Son, the incarnate deity in flesh, has come into our world, when men turn away from him, they condemn themselves. And that's what I think we have here. Now, he continues, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees who were with him heard this and asked him, we are not blind, are we? Might we see Matthew 15, 14, Matthew 23, 24. The syntax expects a no answer. Jesus answered them, if you were blind, you would not be guilty. But now you keep on claiming, we can see, so your sin remains. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, this is a castigation of modern religiosity. I don't care what you do for God, how many times you've been baptized, or how many religious rituals you've gone through, how many moral rules you keep, or how well you know your Bible, or how often you pray. Religiosity without a personal relationship with Jesus Christ is going to be the damnation of many, many thousands of people. Some of us are so proud because of our own religious acts that we forget that we've done all we had, all we can. We're simple slaves and unworthy slaves. We must remember that the central focus of the New Testament is not morality or rules or regulations. These PhDs in religion, though they knew a lot of facts and had a lot of personal piety and a lot of rules about every area in your life, Jesus says they were blind and didn't even know it. Oh, what a tragedy that our church are full of people who think they're safe because they do religious things or keep a few rules. Friends, you're not safe unless you know Jesus in a personal way. Unless you can go back to a time where you knowingly have transferred your trust in yourself and your religious actions to complete trust in Jesus and His finished work on the cross. Now, I'm dealing with people who are the religious leaders. I don't care how bad you are. I don't care how far away you are from God. God loves you, and He's on your trail like that blind beggar. I don't care how high and mighty you are, or how moral or socially accepted, or how religious your life seems. If you don't know Jesus, you're going to spend eternity separated from Him. Know Him. Trust Him. Simple childlike faith. An act of transferring your faith from you and your works to Jesus and His works. I've enjoyed being with you. I'll see you again. Same time, same place.